Struggling with choppy playback in Premiere Pro? Let's turn that around. I'm going to reveal how proxies can supercharge your editing, even on basic setups. Are you ready to edit smoother and faster? Let's dive in. Imagine you're given a fantastic job by a client. It's a tight turnaround, as it always is, but it's a real fun one to do. And suddenly, your computer slogs. You can barely get through the timeline without it frame dropping all the time. Frustrating, right? But proxies are your secret weapon against frame drops, scrubbing and trimming to your heart's delight. That's saving you time. Working smarter, not harder. That's what we do here at DigiPro Tips. Sure, creating proxies takes a little bit of time and storage, but the efficiency gain is a game changer. Ever wondered how those Hollywood editors manage those big movie projects? You're about to learn one of their secret techniques. In film editing, traditional proxy workflows means editing with the proxies and saving the camera originals for the big tasks like conforming and grading. This is the standard for film and TV, especially when there's turnovers involved, and these proxies are usually made outside of Premiere Pro. On the flip side, Premiere Pro's own proxy workflow is perfect for shorter, turnover-free projects. It's usually smooth sailing, but watch out for some common pitfalls. Let's explore how proxies can actually make your editing faster and way more efficient. Premiere Pro makes tracking proxies a breeze. To switch between proxies and originals, just hit the Enable Proxies button in the Program or Source Monitor. Can't find the button? Simply add it using the Button Editor. That's the little plus sign thing in the bottom of your monitor corner. Keep tabs on your proxy status in the timeline with the Show Proxy Badges in the timeline display settings. That's the wrench icon. Blue badge, your proxy enabled and connected. Red badge, your proxy's gone AWOL. Gray badge, proxies are off duty. No badge, you're either proxy free or it's unhooked. For the nitty gritty on each clip's proxy life, head over to the project panel and bins. Right click a column header and choose metadata display and drag that proxy column across. You can also find the enable proxies in the preferences. That's preferences, media, enable proxies. This setting syncs up across your program monitor, source monitor, and preferences, keeping your proxy life in harmony. In Premiere Pro's world, when you're rendering previews, proxies are out of the picture. It's original files time now. Even if you've got proxies and enable proxies switched on, Premiere Pro is kind of like, nope, let's stick with the originals for effect rendering. Yeah, it might slow down rendering, but here's a pro tip. If you use a high quality codec for your previews, you can actually save time with your export. And that is a video all on its own, which I'll link to up here, but you can save a lot of time with your exports if you use high quality previews. Now, if your original file decides to take a break, goes offline and you can't find it, then Premiere Pro has got your back and will use the proxy to render in the final output. And one last thing on this section, if you have got some heavy effects on your timeline on certain clips, Premiere Pro likes to use the originals for those, proxy or no proxy. If you want it to use the proxies when you're making previews, make sure you make that original file offline. Now on to exporting in Premiere Pro, and it's usually all about the original files, even if you're set up with proxies. If you want to make things faster and use your proxies for your export, you can do that by hitting the Use Proxies checkbox under the general settings in your export. Pro tip, if you are just sending a WIP to a client and it's not your final export, you can mix and match your previews and your proxies and let Premiere Pro fly through that export because it is not having to use your original camera files. It has got your previews and your proxies locked in. So we've had a quick look at how to manage proxies in Premiere Pro, but there are some common pitfalls you can avoid. Stick around because I'll uncover these and exactly how to tackle them. In Premiere Pro's proxy world, your proxy clips need to match the original files in frame rate, fielding, duration, and audio channels. Frame size can vary as long as it divides evenly from the original. For example, a 1920x1080 clip can pair with a 960x540 or a 1440x1080. If you have mismatched audio channels, that's going to throw up a flag from Premiere Pro and your proxies won't connect. Stick to these rules and your proxy workflow will be plain sailing. Dealing with variable frame rate footage from smartphones or certain cameras can throw a wrench in your Premiere Pro Proxy process. Even with apps like Filmic Pro, you might set a frame rate of 25 frames per second, but you will actually end up with a frame rate of 25.0041, for example. This tiny difference can mess up playback when making QuickTime proxies, which stick to a standard constant frame rate, causing mismatches with your footage. Premiere Pro and Media Encoder can't make proxies for footage with variable frame rates. But there is hope with these workarounds. You can transcode to, say, ProRes 422 for a constant frame rate. You can interpret the footage to sync with the proxy's frame rate. Or you could opt for H.264 proxies over QuickTime, especially if you don't need multi-channel audio. Keep in mind though, if you've got really long clips, say like a half an hour's worth of footage in one clip, then transcoding or interpreting those clips could throw off your sync near the end of that file. H.264 proxies are generally simpler, but not packed with multi-channel audio like QuickTime proxies are. If you know you've just got a tiny little bit of that really long clip that you want to use, just use Render and Replace to create a constant proxy in a 422 format, for example, just for that bit. If playback's still choppy, consider making a proxy just for this section. If all your team members are going to be using proxies, then have just one person make the proxies and then share them to your Creative Cloud or another shared storage device, maybe a NAS, for example, which I have plenty of videos on how to use and set up those right up there. And then share them out between all of your users that are going to be using those proxies. This way, only one person has to make the proxies and it won't get complicated with different people using different settings. Premiere Pro making proxies can be a breeze at any stage of your editing. For a smooth ride, let Premiere Pro do the heavy lifting semi-automatically. Quick tip, just going back to those audio channels, make sure you haven't modified any of your channels before creating your proxies, otherwise you are going to have to do some manual proxy attaching. Here's a quick guide to automatic creation of proxies in Premiere Pro. Select your source clips in a bin, right-click and hit Proxy, Create Proxies, or your own shortcut. Choose QuickTime and pick a ProRes proxy resolution. Low is 1024 by 540 pixels, medium is 1280 by 720 pixels, or high is 1536 by 790 pixels. And if you want a watermark on your proxies, you can go ahead. It helps in spotting them quite easily. Stash your proxies in a dedicated folder or on a speedy SSD or NVMe drive. Normally, stick with ProRes Proxy unless you've got a good reason not to. If you're tight on storage, say you're out in the field or you're collaborating remotely, then consider H.264 proxies. But remember, they're more taxing on your system and they don't come with multi-channel audio. While your proxies are cooking in the background, you can keep an eye on them by looking at the status indicator or the progression circle. If you do spot a hiccup, you can abort the mission while the Create Proxy Jobs is still up. If it's gone past that point, don't worry, you can hop over into Adobe Media Encoder and stop or pause the queue there. Obviously, Premiere Pro has got its built-in automation for proxy creation, so the manual side isn't usually needed that much anymore, but for vertical and weird frame sizes, it's still pretty handy to know. Here's a quick guide for how you can whip up your own custom proxy presets. Kick off with an export preset in Media Encoder, right-click on source clip, hit Export Media and create a new export preset. Pick QuickTime and ProRes Proxy, then tailor the frame size to your needs. Remember, you can match the frame size or frame rate to your source, but pick one. If you match both, you're in transcode territory. Move on to an ingest preset. Grab that shiny new export preset and create an ingest preset with it. Name it something snappy, set it to transcode files to destination, choose your go-to proxies folder and select QuickTime format with your export preset. Save it as a file. Export this ingest preset from Adobe Media Encoder as a .epr file, jump into Premiere Pro, head to Create Proxies and click Add Ingest Preset. Find and select your .epr file and then you are done. If you only need proxies for specific timeline clips, then you could use a search bin. Pick a metadata column that's not in use, like log note or comment. Tag your sequence clips with a unique identifier like proxy, then create a search bin using this unique tag. Select these clips in the search bin and get those proxies rolling. In Premiere Pro, attaching clips with mismatched audio channels throws up a trigger warning and isn't actually possible. Mismatches in other video parameters might not warn you, but will throw up problems later. Pro tip, you can speed up your workflow by assigning a shortcut for attach proxies in your keyboard shortcuts dialog. If proxy files are offline when you open up a project, Premiere Pro will use the link media dialog for you to relink your proxy files there. If you skip this, you'll need to manually attach proxies later. Choosing offline or offline all for media and then saving means that you won't have that relink dialog box next time you open it up. If you've got proxy clips only in Premiere Pro, use the Reconnect full resolution media to pair them up with their original camera files. This is found in the same spot as attach proxies. This option opens a dialog that turns your clip into a proxy, and the chosen one in the dialog becomes your new full resolution original. Fun fact, Reconnect full resolution media works even if your proxies and originals share the same resolution. If you've already got a proxy attached, it will stay put and only the full res part will get swapped. Heads up though, this move is final. If your original file goes missing after you've saved your project, don't worry, your relink dialog box will open next time you open the project. If you want to keep the originals out of the equation, then just hit cancel or offline all. This dialog also pops up if clips go missing whilst the project is open. Even after opening a project, don't worry if the dialog box goes away or you cancelled it. You can still get it back up at any point during the project. Another tip, you can assign a keyboard shortcut to bring this dialog box up whenever you want and reconnect and link media whenever you need to. If you don't want your proxies anymore, then there's a simple solution. Right click on your clip and select detach proxies. And don't worry, this won't scrub your proxies from your disk. These could be used in other places in your project. You call the shots on keeping them or deleting them. Oh, and yep, detach proxies can be a shortcut as well if you want it to. So we've just uncovered the essentials of proxy workflows, but stick around because I'm going to show you some pro tips that take your editing to the next level. Now, After Effects handles proxies a little bit differently from Premiere Pro, given that real-time playback isn't really as key. Here's how to do proxies in After Effects. Right-click on a clip in the project panel, select Create Proxy Movie or a still image for static shots. After Effects then adds each clip as a composition to the render queue. Render it to whip up a movie or a Photoshop image. On Windows, AVI is the default, but you can switch to ProRes Proxy Mob. In the project panel, proxies get their own icons, filled squares for active proxies and empty ones for disabled. Heads up, After Effects proxies are often bulkier than the originals because they are uncompressed. Creating proxies for entire compositions might be more up your alley, especially with After Effects' latest updates for multi-frame rendering and hardware-accelerated decoding. Now, if you've got After Effects and Premiere Pro in your workflow, Dynamic Link now plays nicely with proxies. You can send a Premiere Pro clip to After Effects and toggle that proxy in After Effects as well. And if you had watermarks in Premiere Pro, they'll show up in After Effects when the proxy is enabled. You need to remember to disable the proxies in After Effects when working back in Premiere Pro for the originals to show up. Now, I've helped many clients out of problems they've got themselves into with proxy workflows in Premiere Pro. Most of the time, if not every time, it's because people don't understand the limitations of proxy workflows. The most common scenario is when people have 4K source files but are working in Ultra HD, making proxies in Ultra HD. It's not really 4K, but it's close. Ultra HD is 3840 by 2160 pixels. However, 4K or true 4K is 4096 by 2160. The difference in width is what creates those black bars. Create your proxy presets with stretch to fill or use the built-in presets to eradicate that problem. Remember the frustration of slow editing we talked about at the start? Yet that's now a thing of the past. For a almost automatic method, let Premiere Pro handle your proxies in the background using its built-in presets. However, if you want to create your own custom presets because maybe you're using vertical video, then you can use the guide I just showed you. If you intend to import proxies made by cameras or by other people with the intention of reconnecting the original media later, you want to test that workflow. This is to ensure the workflow works as expected. Usually it's plain sailing, but not always. You want to test it first. Now, if you've still got choppy playback in Premiere, there might be a selection of different colored bars above your timeline. That is your render bar, and that is something you also need to know about. And I've got a video just on that very same thing, right here.